your prompt.
Oh, on the paper?
Yeah, it's really good.
Thank you.
And then write this on your sheet. So as you can see, number one at the top is yama, and all the way down to number eight, samadhi. So number one is the most external. So write that down, explain what it means. And number eight is the most internal. So we're moving from external to internal as we proceed through. And that'll make a little bit more sense as we go. All right, any questions so far? So number one is the yamas, and as you can see, this breaks down into subgroups. There's five underneath it. The word yamas in Sanskrit literally translates to restraints. When we think of the word restraint, we might think that it's something that we are restraining to do, like we should stay away from it. It means the opposite. It means that it's a restraint that we want to put on ourselves. It's a positive connotation. So just want to throw that out there so it's not confusing. So the very first one under the yamas is ahimsa. You guys have probably heard that, right? Who's seen it on like a shirt or something? Yes. I know a yoga studio that's called ahimsa yoga.
Yeah, just there.
Right. So it's a very common word. This might be the one that you're most familiar with. And it literally translates to non-harming. So when we think of non-harming, we can think of physically. We don't want to harm others, right? We don't want to harm any living creatures. But go a little bit deeper, and that's what we're going to do during the entire lecture here. What about non-harming thoughts, non-harming words, non-harming actions, right? And we tend to be really good at not harming other people intentionally. What about ourselves? What type of thoughts are we thinking in our own head, and are they harmful to our own well-being? So the word that comes up for this is compassion. Like if you had to have one takeaway from ahimsa, it would be compassion for all creatures, all walks of life, everything. Now here's my question for you guys, and we're gonna do this for each one as we move through. In your yoga practice, how does ahimsa show up? What are you thinking?
Honoring our edge.
Yeah.
And not getting competitive.
compassion to yourself for just showing up no matter what your practice is going to look like. It could be child's pose the whole time, but you're showing yourself.
Yeah,
it's beautiful. Compassion by being there.
A lot of the ahimsa in our practice involves the thoughts that we have towards ourselves. So it comes back to of ourselves instead of others. But sometimes there might be judgmental thoughts towards who you're practicing next to also. So it can also apply the opposite way. All right, the second one under the subgroup of the yamas is satya. So it's pronounced S-A-T-I-A, satya. And this means truthfulness, or also known as non-lying. So this is speaking the truth. And this goes even further than just speaking the truth. Once again, this also is truthful thoughts, truthful actions, truthful words. So you can already see this is all-encompassing. We're not just talking about the physical 3D world, what our minds tend to go to right away. There's a lot more to these. So this is not only being honest with others, but again, honest with ourselves. And the words that pop out for this one is authenticity and integrity. There's two takeaways. We know how important is authenticity, right? You know when somebody's being authentic versus not authentic. You can feel that vibrational difference. So in practice, we're going to keep comparing this. How would satya, this truthfulness, how would this show up in our practice?
I always think of your throat chakra, speaking your truth.
Yeah.
And you know, sometimes those blockages, you're kind of like complacent, kind of just going to go with it.
Moving through emotions.
Emotion, yeah. And not really honoring where you're at or saying it's a, you know.
The honoring where you're at. And this is going to be a huge theme throughout all of these. Honor where you're at, honor where you're at. But that's such a great point with the throat chakra, because that's what this one encompasses, is that truthfulness. And that's what throat chakra really shines with. What I wrote down here is just being truthful in how you're showing up on your mat. So again, same concept, just being very honest with yourself. Especially with what you're capable of versus what you're not, because every day is different. Some days you have that handstand, and then other days you're like, absolutely not, just not working with my body. Okay, third one underneath the subgroup is asteya, which means non-stealing. And this encompasses not taking anything that doesn't belong to us. And we know this, right? Like these are concepts that we've all heard before, some of them even from our religious practices. But again, this is more just a philosophical guideline to living. So physical items, of course, we don't want to steal, but let me pose this question to you guys. Would I be stealing something from somebody if they were sharing that they just got engaged, right? They're so excited about it. And my response is, oh, that's great. Oh, by the way, I'm pregnant. Is that stealing somebody's thunder? Is that a similar way of stealing, even though it's not physically stealing? It can be looked at that. And I'm not pregnant. That was just an example. So this can include stealing someone's thunder, stealing their energy, but then also apply it to yourself, because you can also steal your own energy by not remaining present. Okay, because you're thinking about tomorrow, or you're thinking about what happened yesterday. So the one thing that kind of pops out with this one, the takeaway, is non-judgment and gratitude. So same thing, in our practice, how would asteya start to show up? This non-stealing. So it might be a little tougher.
If you see someone like doing a cool, like a great expression of a pose, and you like have it one step further, just being like, hey, look at me, do it farther.
That's a really good one.
Yeah.
Having more of that competitive mindset, which yoga is not competitive, we know that, but sometimes people come to class and their energy is competitive, and then the people around them pick that up, and it can be misinterpreted, for sure. So no, that's a great attempt. Awesome. All right, let's keep on moving on. So number four, underneath the yamas, this is a mouthful, okay? Brahmacharya is how it's pronounced. And it means non-excess. I think on your sheet it says, yeah, sexual continence, which is a part of it, but write down non-excess and walking with the divine.
Mm-hmm.
not overindulging in the pleasures of life. So the pleasures of life, we think of, you know, food, overeating, even overworking too. Not that that necessarily is pleasurable, but you get the point. We don't want to be overindulging in anything. So even when it comes to sex, and a big one with this one is to abstain from sexual misconduct. Okay, so it's not saying abstinence in total, but especially misconduct. Oversleeping, and then also drugs and alcohol too, right? We overindulge. So this one really likes to focus on activities and people that lift you up and that don't drag you down. Because have you guys ever felt that you've put so much energy and effort into some of these overindulgent things and then you feel drained at the end of it? Because it's taking all your energy and your focus can't go to other things that are more important. So things that come up for this, for keywords, moderation, focus, and presence. In our practice, how would brahmacharya come up? So walking with the divine, non-access.
Maybe not getting stuck, like often teacher will open up an opportunity to play, and it's important to continue on with class and not getting too stuck. You want to continue to balance out the practice by following your teacher's cues. I know students that will kind of break away from the guidance of the teacher because they want to keep playing.
Right.
Yeah.
That touches on that access, like being able to just know, like, oh, this might be too access. I mean, you can even take physical activity. If you work out way too much, you're exhausted, and that's overindulging, that's access. So this is just, moderation is key. And you've heard that before. People say, you know, everything in moderation. It's a saying that we have. Last one under the yamas is, here's another mouthful, a parigraha, which is non-grasping, non-attachments. And we know that, non-attachment in yoga, right? So to take only what's necessary and to release attachments to outcomes, to people, to places, to things. And how hard is that in reality to do? It's incredibly hard. Our minds, our egos like to be hyper-focused on these attachments. Hello. Come on in. This also includes decluttering of our space because we're attached to items. We're attached to so many things in the physical world. So when you start to declutter and like Marie Kondo it, you know, like really get things out, if nothing brings you joy, it's time to go. That is going to bring this parigraha into more light. So the things that come up for this one, obviously non-attachment is a big word, and then no comparison. This might be easy, but in our practice, how can we practice the parigraha?
Comparing yourself to other people.
Yeah. That was easy, right? Not comparing yourself to others. But also, what about not comparing yourself to your highest potential that you know you have in your practice on a bad day, so to speak. You know, because every day is different on the mat. So we fall into that comparison trap so easily. Okay, any questions on the yamas? Pretty straightforward for the most part. Things we've heard of, it all makes sense. Moving on to number 2 of the 8 is the niyamas. And this word in Sanskrit literally translates to non-restraint. Also known as observances. So again, there's 5 underneath the niyamas, and the first one is saucha, which means purity and cleanliness. So first thing that our minds usually go to is physical purity and cleanliness, like make sure you put on deodorant during your practice, right? That's the very easy thing to think about. But let's dive a little bit deeper. This also means purity of thoughts, purity of mind, purity of spirit. How about that? And there's a quote by Gandhi that really sums this one up. You don't have to write it down, but My thoughts are my beliefs. My beliefs become my actions. My actions become my habits. My habits become my destiny. So this one is a big link to our thoughts create our reality, because they do, law of attraction. So in our practice, how would saucha come up besides wearing deodorant and making sure that you shower and are not stinky and smelly?
Regularly releasing the thoughts as we come into our practice to kind of let them float away, not get stuck or let a negative spiral happen.
Yes, just keeping them pure towards yourselves and towards others. A lot of these are intertwining now. You probably noticed that already. Okay, second one underneath the niyamas is santosha, which is contentment or equanimity. And equanimity means this equalization, this harmonious space of mind, body, and soul. So this one includes being grateful for what you have, because if we're grateful for what we have now, we'll become even more grateful as more abundance flows into our life. It's a direct relationship. So a word that pops out for this is acceptance and gratitude. And how do we find acceptance in our practice? Letting go of expectations. Have you ever heard expectation is the root cause of all evil? Mm-hmm. Or holding expectations or the root cause of suffering? Because it is. When we think X, Y, or Z is going to happen and then it doesn't happen, who gets upset? Right? So it's releasing all of those expectations, coming to a place of acceptance. And when you accept something, are you happy? Are you content? Are you equanimous? I might have just made up that word. But, right? You usually are.
It was believable, though.
Thank you. I was like, go with it. So there's this wonderful quote by Johnny Kest, who is the creator of Life Power. You might have known that already, Danette. But he said, no amount of self-improvement can make up for a lack of self-acceptance. That's powerful. Makes sense. Mm. Okay, third one under the niyamas is tapas, and it's not the appetizer. Okay, it's not that. So if your mind's going there, pull back. But this translates to fire, to heat, and to effort. And this actually kind of makes sense, because is yoga hard? Like physically? Yeah, like you get your butt kicked usually. So this is speaking towards heat, but heat purifies things. So we're connecting this back with that purification, that saucha. And you can think of it like this. Heat, like when we're cooking, the heat to our food is purifying it. It's killing off any bacteria, any fungi, you know. So it's that same concept with our bodies. When our bodies are heated up, it's this purification process that begins. The word that comes up with this one, self-discipline, and this is huge. Self-discipline requires effort, a lot of effort. Anything worth having in life is not easy, right, that whole concept. So in our practice, what builds the fire? What builds the heat in our bodies? This is a really, really simple one.
Digestion.
Yes, I think that's true. It does. There's such thing as digestive fire. So yes. But what's the first thing that a yoga teacher will do at the beginning of class? We cue the breath. So right away, that breath is heating up our body, especially like an Ujjayi pranayama, which is literally known as victorious fire breath. And yes, that self-discipline eventually becomes a habit, and then it becomes your lifestyle. So tapas is a really cool one. It's an easy one to kind of see as it moves forward. Okay, another mouthful, fourth one underneath. Svidyaya is the pronunciation, and it means the study of oneself. So this is just introspection to studying our true self, and we do this in the form of meditation within our yoga practice. But then there's some yoga practices, such as a yin, that it is meditative, even though you're not sitting and cross-legged the entire time. It is more of that meditative practice. So this can apply to more of the physical asana and not just sitting still in meditation. This is where the ego begins to dissolve once we connect to our true essence, which is our soul, our spirit, source energy, God, the universe. Doesn't matter what words you put to it. Remember, not religious, more spiritual. So in our practice, how does this show up? The studying of oneself.
I think this is where you get yoga's different than Pilates or some other workout, because through the asana you're doing something else, and that's why yoga's different.
Yeah, no, it's so true. And you're studying yourself the entire practice. Like, have you ever been in a pose for a while and you're like, oh my God, I never felt that muscle before, or this part of my body, like, you didn't even know it was there. Or even with the breath, you never thought you can breathe as deeply as you did. So there's so many different aspects that you can dive into that self-study. Yoga is the vehicle to get there. Okay, last one under the niyamas is another mouthful, Ishvara Pranidhana, which is devotion or surrender to the divine. On your sheet it says Lord, but again, it's whatever word that you want to replace in those parentheses. So surrendering to the bigger picture, and when we do that, we eliminate the ego, which is our thinking conscious mind, and we start to connect to something higher than ourselves. You guys probably know this, but we're not in control of what happens to us in life, but we are in control of how we react to it. And choosing to accept it and surrender to the grand picture, that's a choice. It is an absolute choice. So in our practice, how do we practice surrendering? Because that's the key takeaway for this one, surrender.
Pigeon pose.
Say pigeon?
Yeah.
Any posture that is tough for you, yeah. Especially in a yin practice, like we just talked about. You're surrendering the entire practice because you have nothing else to do but sit in a pose for 5 to 10 minutes. So you have no other choice but to let go. So, yeah, that one's a very easy one.
That's my TV watching pose. So.
Is that interesting? Everyone's so different. I love pigeon, too.
Everyone hates on
down.
Pigeon.
You just give it up, you know, you're just like the physical representation of that pose. Like,
oh, yeah. Absolutely. Any questions, you guys, on the niyamas? Okay. So, moving on to number 3 then, which this one should be very well known, asana, which is the physical postures that we do in yoga. And 2 main things that this is going to touch on is the steadiness and the ease. So you want to write those down. And you might have heard them before. In Sanskrit, we call them the sthira and the sukha in our practice. I'll spell those out for you. Sthira is S-T-H-I-R-A, and that means steadiness. Sukha, S-U-K-H-A, and that means ease. So cool part about sthira and sukha is every single pose can whether it's child's pose or whether it's handstand. There's a balance between the strength aspect of the posture or the steadiness and then the ease aspect of the posture or the flexibility of it. So it's just this sliding scale, if you want to think of it, because we have people who are naturally more strong than they are flexible, and then people who are more flexible than they are strong. So we all fall to one extreme or the other. Yoga tries to bring the union of those two so that you're right smack dab in the middle of that sliding scale. So there's a big play on opposites, especially you'll hear yoga teachers use a lot of cues, like, who's heard like Root to Rise? Like, it's a festival, right? We literally just went to it a month ago. So rooting down would be that steadiness, you're being steadied and steadied and strength. And then with the ease would be that rising up, you're growing tall, you're growing wings, however you want to look at it. So important, especially for YTT, when you start to practice cueing, think about playing on those opposites and figuring out how to bring steadiness and ease into the words that you use. Really powerful. Any questions on asana? Because that one is very, it's in our practice. We know it. We can see it. It's tangible. Okay. Number 4. Pranayama, concept. It's in our practice. It's tangible. We can feel our breath. We can hear the teacher cue it. It makes sense to us. I'm going to break down the word because I did not know this actually until maybe a week ago or so. But prana, P-R-A-N-A, that is life force energy, which some of you might have heard of. And then yama, it's that same word as number one of the limb. That means restraint. Also known as control, restraint control. So what does pranayama mean then? Like put those two together. What would you describe it as?
That's breath control.
Yep. Boom. Breath control. That's exactly what it is. And I didn't realize that it was that simple. I mean, I put the two together as well. It makes sense now. So it's this mastery of our life force energy, which is our breath. It brings us nutrients every single day, oxygen, and it keeps us living, keeps our heart beating, keeps our cells healthy and active. It is our life force. The pranayama, the main goal of it in yoga, despite what breath is used, because we have ujjayi pranayama, we have durga pranayama, which is a three-part complete breath, and then there's a ton of other breathing patterns that include retention breathing, things like that. But the main point of the breath in practice is to calm the mind. So here's a really good question for you guys. Have you done any other workout besides yoga in your life?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yes. So just throw out some other workouts. Like, was it Zumba? Was it lifting, running? Like, what have you done besides yoga?
Lifting, Pilates.
Okay.
Running.
Okay.
Just circuit training, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Cross training.
Yeah.
Jump rope.
Okay.
Roller skating.
So fun. Yeah, that's a workout.
Text driving children.
That is a workout too. Yes.
That's
your career.
Yeah. Exactly. So all those workouts that you just threw out, go back in time to when you performed those workouts. When you left, how did you feel compared to leaving a yoga class? Just what are some words that come to mind that yoga brought you that those workouts?
Yoga with more energy than I leave a run.
Mm-hmm.
About centeredness, a balanced feeling,
mm-hmm.
a calm equanimity, back to that word, focused. And it's all in the means of the breath. That's it. It's because we use pranayama in yoga, whereas in weightlifting, for example, they actually hold their breath for certain parts of their weightlifting.
The maneuver.
Yes.
Yep, that's a
problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but how good are they gonna feel? How clear headed are they gonna feel from holding their breath during their, strenuous workout too, so to speak, compared to something where we're mindfully connecting with it. So that's what the pranayama does for us. It brings us balance and focus. Okay. So remember, we're continuing to get more internal as we move down. So I was telling them that the number one, so the yama, is the most external, and then samadhi is the most internal. So we're making that way internal. So number five, pratyahara. And this translates to withdrawal of the senses. So this can be internalization with meditation. But this could also be, for example, when you're taking a yoga class and the teacher asks you to close your eyes during a certain part of the class. You're way more internalized. You're feeling everything. It's almost amplified because you withdrew one of your senses, and then your other senses start to grow. Like, you might have heard people who have who are blind or who are deaf, their other senses actually overcompensate for the lack of sense. So same concept here. When you withdraw one sense, other things start to pop up, and magic starts to happen from within. So where your attention goes, your energy flows. That's a really good quote for this one. And we have the choice of where we focus our energy. So super powerful. We're always putting that back in the hands of the individual. You have a choice for all of these things. You control your mind. Your mind does not control you. That type of thing. So in our practice, how would pratyahara show up, this withdrawal of the senses, besides closing your eyes? Where do we put our focus in our practice? That's a good question to ask. First couple things the teacher cues. What is we are withdrawing inwards towards to recalibrate and then put the focus on something else. That's probably hard. Okay, number six, dharana, which is holding concentration. In your sheet, it says binding of the mind. So this is focusing on one single object, one single thought, one single feeling. And how honestly, how often do we do that? Like in the real world. We are multitaskers. And the worst part is in westernized culture, we take pride in multitasking, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, I did X, Y, and Z today. You only did X. Like, what, you know, what's going on? Why didn't you do more? So we you know, should it be that way? That's a whole other discussion. But we take pride in it normally, and we try to do the most always. But imagine, what would happen if you laser-focused on one thing? Think about the quality of that one thing, whether it's a project you're doing, or a pose, or your breath, or your mindset. Think about how that would grow and expand if you put all your attention on just that thing. So in our practice, this kind of comes back. It's that focus. Where is our focus going? To the breath, like we said, the drishti, the gaze, to an intention, as you mentioned. So same concepts. These last couple start to intertwine, okay? And it's because it's philosophy. It's something very abstract. So we'll keep moving through, but if you have questions, I will answer them towards the end. So number seven is dhyana, which means meditation. This is contemplation, insight, your full attention going towards something. And we kind of touched on this with the breath work, with pranayama, but what meditation does for us is very similar. It frees us from our binds, from our fluctuating mind, from our pain, from our sorrow, from our losses, from whatever it is that we're trying to heal through. It reconnects you with the bigger picture, source energy. The words that come up for dhyana is awareness and acceptance. So that's what we're aiming for in meditation. So in our practice, this might show up as being instead of doing. And this might be a little bit more out there for you guys, but let me put it this way. Have you ever been to a yoga class and it flies by and you're like, oh my God, I was so lost in the moment, I didn't even realize time went by that fast? You were practicing dhyana, whether you knew it or not. It's getting lost in something because your being, that's a very soulful thing, your being with your soul versus doing. Doing is of the ego, of the thinking mind. Okay. Very last one, number eight, which is the most internal of all, samadhi. And this one on the sheet says unification. It's also known as enlightenment. Wholeness. Or even self-actualization. You guys know Maslow's hierarchy? Yeah, the very top of the pyramid, that's that self-actualization. Yeah, that's this guy. That's this guy way down here. So this is where universal consciousness starts to merge with your own individual consciousness. You become enlightened. You become one with all that was, all that is, and all that will be. Very abstract. Might be hard to wrap your head around it, but I guarantee that you guys have felt this at one point during your yoga practice. Because you get lost in the moment with the dhyana, and all of a sudden, everything becomes one. Because you're not, it sounds weird to say, but you're not using your thinking mind. You're so immersed in this spiritual experience. You're a spirit in a body, not a body in a spirit. That type of thing. So this is total liberation and the realization that everything is connected. So to kind of compare these last two, because they can be a little bit confusing, think of a match. If I were to take a match and light it, the initial spark, so not actually setting flame, but just the initial spark of the match is dhyana. So one up, number seven. That's that meditation. That's the initial spark. once the flame takes hold and begins to sustain itself and burn and burn and burn, that is samadhi. That's this universal consciousness becoming aware in your own being. Okay? And you can think of that flame as it's melting away the separation of ego versus soul, because it's enlightenment. You're one with all. These can be kind of in depth. I mean, as you can tell probably. They're very philosophical. Good. Thank you. So any questions on the last number 3 to 8 pretty much before I wrap up?
I was just going to say that samadhi, I think people are constantly like looking for something instead of just listening or being or accepting it. It's going to look different for everybody.
Yeah, that's
right?
A beautiful concept. So what I take from that is we're very destination oriented.
Right.
They get something in their mind and they're like, oh, I'm going to go do X, Y, and Z to get to that destination. They're missing out on the journey, and what happens during the journey is you get insight coming to you. When you're not looking for it, things come out of the blue when you're not looking for them. That's usually how, and they're usually the best things too that come out of the blue when you're not looking for them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a beautiful point on it. And the surrender is part of that too. They have to surrender.
And it might just be that glimpse, that moment.
Mm-hmm.
It might not be, oh, I'm enlightened all day long,
right?
And I walk around as I am so enlightened. But it's coming back to that, just like coming back to the breath. It's like, can you get to that moment?
Right. Well, you have it, hit it on the nail. Because you've all felt samadhi, whether you know it or not. I mean, if you practice yoga enough, there's been some point in time, it could be a split second, but you felt it. It was there. You know, and the people who really have found true enlightenment, we think of Gandhi, we think of Buddha, right? And that is like a full state of enlightenment, like almost 24/7, and that's hard. I mean, we wouldn't be able to live in our Western culture if that was the case. There's too many external things that we would be distracted with, so to speak. That's why monks, they live in monasteries. They're put away from, you know, the culture that everyone else is immersed in. So last kind of thing to wrap this whole lecture up on the eight limbs is how the eight limbs connect to yoga in general. So I teach at Lifetime, okay? And it's Life Power Yoga, that's the name of their program there. So we have a vinyasa class, which is just like any vinyasa yoga. It's just the Life Power brand of yoga. And our Life Power vinyasa is rooted in Vipassana. Have you heard of the Vipassana meditation before? It's that 10-day meditation where you go and it's just as it sounds. You sit for 10 days and you meditate. There's no talking to anybody. I mean, you get to eat, but that's it. It's silent. A silent retreat for 10 days. So the point of a Vipassana is to self-observe. You really get to know yourself. Some things start to come up, just as you had touched on, because you're being quiet and you're listening more than doing. And that's the whole concept behind our yoga philosophy for vinyasa, as it is for many vinyasa classes, is to have this self-observance and then that self-study and then that self-growth. Okay. And this might make sense too. So Buddha, have you heard of the Eightfold Path from Buddha? Some of it's very similar to the eight limbs of yoga. So Buddha came before Patanjali. Patanjali was the one that created the eight limbs. So really the thought process is that Patanjali took from Buddha's teaching of the Eightfold Path and took it into his eight limbs. Now, how that got to a yoga practice, because remember, Ashtanga means eight limbs, but it is not originating with Patanjali, is Pattabhi Joyce. So it's like this lineage. You know, if I were to draw a chart, it's one thing led to the next, like this domino effect, and we were left with Ashtanga Vinyasa, which we teach at Lifetime too, but you can get Ashtanga anywhere, and it's a very traditional practice. It's the same practice every time you go to it. So my point on this one was both the eight limbs of yoga and Buddha's Eightfold Path are meant to seize the fluctuations of the mind. That's the goal. And that's also the goal of yoga. So there's this intertwinement between all three. yoga, eightfold, and eight limbs. And last little thing that I will touch on is that Ashtanga Vinyasa is the practice, the physical asana practice. It's tangible. We can touch it because it's in the 3D world. We can physically know, okay, we're breathing, we're moving. In Ashtanga, we're practicing all these eight limbs, whether you know it or not. It's one of those things that is kind of, it's secretly weaved into practice. But somebody might say to you, yes, I practice Ashtanga. And that might mean just the eight limbs, okay? So just as to keep that in mind, some people do not do the physical Ashtanga Vinyasa practice, but they might be an Ashtangi in the sense that they practice the eight limbs, okay? There's a lot of, not confusion, but almost so, that there's different meanings to some of these words. Okay, last thing I'm gonna leave you with is one more quote. Tavi Joyce, the creator of Ashtanga, said it. Yoga is 99% practice, 1% theory, okay? And that should make sense after this, because this is theory, right? This is all theoretical, but what does it mean without practice? Nothing, absolutely nothing. Any questions, my friends, on any of this? Or insight even, like, was there an aha moment where you were like, wow, this really makes sense now?
I feel like your match analogy, I think that was good to sort of separate that out. That was something new that I hadn't heard, and I like that. It brought some clarity.
Thank you, Liz.
The visuals and the quotes that you paired with each lesson and each segment of this philosophy was really important. Even the keywords that you pulled out were really positive and remind us things that we can do to practice something that, again, is kind of tough with the language and the translation that it brings us. So you did a great job.
I watched a documentary and they were talking about the Thomas, and they had like certain ones that they wanted them to follow, that you would be vegetarian for, you know, this number of weeks, you know, you would refrain from having sex, and the reasoning from all, you know, from doing all of these things is so that you could focus in on your yoga, and that's all. Like, you don't have the distraction, so you're taking that away. Really, you know,
self-discipline,
but
yeah.
Right. But you know, it was kind of funny when I was reading that. I was like, oh, well, that's restraint. You know, I was like, oh, but wait, you
right.
know, but it does make sense now.
It gets confusing
yeah.
because the word restraint, we just think it's such a negative connotation that we pair with it usually. Anything else, you guys? Awesome. Thank you so much.